Hi everyone. Last episode we learned what generators are and how they show up in classical physics. Importantly, we found that energy generates changes in the time of our classical state. This episode, I want to connect this to quantum mechanics to finally derive and demystify the Schrödinger equation. So with that, let's go ahead and get started. First and foremost, what do we mean by time evolution in quantum mechanics? Well, remember that we are trying to model a quantum particle, which we mathematically represent as a quantum state ket in a vector space. As this particle advances in time and interacts with fields and other particles, we expect that the quantum state will also accordingly change in time. Our goal is to find exactly how this quantum state changes and evolves throughout time. To evolve and transform our quantum state in time, it seems clear that we need an operator, which we will call the time evolution operator, denoted here with a big U. This operator takes in a time t, and when acted upon an initial quantum state, will evolve that state forward by t amount of time. So, u of 2 seconds would evolve our quantum state forward by 2 seconds. Before trying to figure out what this time evolution operator actually is, it's a good idea to use our physical intuition to determine some of its properties. So, let's do that. First, what should u of 0 be? Well, this operator time evolves our quantum state by 0 seconds, which means we do nothing to it. We leave it exactly as it was. Therefore, since u of 0 didn't change anything, we expect u of 0 to be the identity operator. Next, we want to use the intuition that we expect that time evolution is reversible. In other words, if we time evolve a particle forward by 2 seconds, it should be possible to time evolve it backwards by 2 seconds and get our initial state back. Mathematically, this means that we expect that time evolution is invertible and U inverse exists. This might seem obvious to state, but in a few moments you'll see why this is an important point. For our last piece of physical intuition, it should be reasonable to expect that when we evolve our quantum state in time, the total probability should be conserved. In other words, even after we evolve the state by time t, we better expect that the total probability, calculated as the inner product with itself, always stays equal to its initial value of 1. Looking at this equation, notice that it's the same property satisfied by unitary operators. And if you need a reminder of what those are, review chapter 11. Well, since we're deriving a very important equation, let's be somewhat rigorous and justify that this property indeed implies unitarity. For simplicity, we'll denote u of t as simply u. So we want to prove that this equation implies that u is unitary. To start, let's pull out the right side u operator and use the Hermitian conjugate of the left u operator to also move it to the middle, giving us the following. Now, let's move everything to the left-hand side and insert an identity operator in between the lone inner product. We can then use the linear property of operators to combine everything into a single inner product. So here we have an operator that when sandwiched in an inner product returns 0, no matter what state we use. To get some more information about this sandwiched operator, let's try taking its Hermitian conjugate. First, we distribute the dagger. The Hermitian conjugate of the identity is itself, and for the left term, we remember the Hermitian product rule, which says we flip the product, then distribute the dagger, which just gives us u dagger u again. But notice, this is exactly what we started with. Therefore, this entire operator is Hermitian. Since this operator is Hermitian, we know that it must have an orthonormal eigenbasis. For simplicity's sake moving forward, let's label this operator as A, and elements of its eigenbasis as AI. Let's now go back to our equation. And let's go ahead and relabel the sandwiched operator with A. Remember that this must be true for any state. So now that we know A has an eigenbasis, let's go ahead and use one of its eigenvectors. A acting on its eigenvector will just give us the eigenvalue. We can pull out the eigenvalue and the remaining inner product of the orthonormal eigenvector equals 1. Therefore, we find that the eigenvalue equals 0. This must hold true for all eigenvectors. Therefore, all of the eigenvalues of A must be 0. Let's now act A on an arbitrary vector. We can expand this vector in A's orthonormal eigenbasis, and move A into the sum. Acting A on an eigenvector will return the eigenvalue, which equals 0. Therefore, we get 0 for every term in this linear combination. Thus, A sends psi to 0. This must be true for any vector. Therefore, we find that this operator must actually be the 0 operator. We can then plug back in our definition for A, and therefore we can conclude that u dagger u is equal to the identity. Now, since we showed that time evolution reversal implies that u inverse exists, we can apply u inverse to both sides. Hence, we have that u dagger equals u inverse, and therefore we have just shown that the time evolution operator is unitary. Before moving forward, I want to reiterate that proving unitarity relied on only two main physical intuitions. 1. Time evolution is reversible. And 2. Probability is conserved throughout time. Remember this, because you'll see that these two intuitions will allow us to derive 90% of the Schrödinger equation. With that, we're finally ready to start digging into exactly how this time evolution operator works. To do so, we will employ a technique that should be in every physicist's toolkit. Finding the action of this operator over arbitrary time t sounds like a really tough problem. A much easier problem is to instead find the action of the operator over an infinitesimally small time dt. Since dt is really small, we can consider the Taylor expansion of this operator to first order. The first term is u of 0. The next term is the derivative at 0 times dt. And for the mathematicians, we'll keep track of terms ordered dt squared and higher. Remember that u of 0 is the identity, so we have the following. Now let's study how this acts on an initial state. Let's apply both sides to an initial quantum state psi. On the left-hand side, we'll simply get a quantum state that is time-evolved forward by dt. Now, if we subtract both sides by psi, then on the left, we now have the difference in our quantum state after time dt. Let's now divide both sides by dt. Now, if we then take the limit as dt goes to 0, do you notice something on the left-hand side? We have the limit of the change in our state divided by the change in time as it goes to 0. That's the definition of a derivative. And for the mathematicians, all higher order terms are still of order dt, so they vanish as we take dt to 0. So we are left with the time derivative of our quantum state being equal to the derivative of the time evolution operator acting on psi. And check that out. By looking at tiny timescales, we have derived a differential equation for the time evolution of our quantum state. So where do we go from here? Well, notice that we still haven't used the information that u is unitary. To input that information, let's analyze the unitary property on the Taylor expansions. First, let's start with this equation, which is true because u dagger is the inverse. We can now plug in the Taylor expansion we derived earlier, where we've distributed the dagger in the first expansion. Let's now multiply these two out. We first get the identity operator, then u dot dagger dt, then u dot dt, and finally, terms of order dt squared and higher. We can cancel both the identities, and then divide both sides by dt. We can then go ahead and send dt to 0. Since the higher order terms are still of order dt, they vanish as dt goes to 0. So if we move a term to the other side, we get the following. The Hermitian conjugate of u dot is equal to the negative of u dot. This means that the derivative of the time evolution operator is anti-Hermitian. Now, this seems like a neat fact, but how does this help us? Well, let's multiply u dot by I. Let's now take the Hermitian conjugate of the operator I u dot. Using the product rule of Hermitian conjugates, we get the following. We just showed that u dot is anti-Hermitian, and the Hermitian conjugate of I is just the complex conjugate, giving us negative I. The two negatives cancel, and we are left with I u dot, which is exactly what we started with. So this operator is actually Hermitian. Therefore, this equals some Hermitian operator, which we'll call H. Dividing both sides by I, we get that u dot is equal to some Hermitian operator divided by I. Now, let's move back to the differential equation we derived. Let's now plug in our expression for u dot. Multiply the I over, and check out what we've got. We have derived that I times the time derivative of our quantum state is equal to some Hermitian operator acting on our state. Those of you familiar with the Schrödinger equation should be very excited right now. What we have just derived is the general form of the Schrödinger equation. Hopefully by this point, you've realized that 90% of the Schrödinger equation comes from unitary time evolution, which we derived from just two principles. Time evolution is reversible, and probability is conserved through time. We've really only used these two physical principles to get to this point. Well, that being said, let's go ahead and finish it up to form the complete Schrödinger equation. Remember that Hermitian operators are closely tied to physical observables. So this seems to point us towards some physical observable that is related to time evolution. We showed last episode that if we want to change just the time in our classical Lagrangian, this is generated by changes in energy, i.e., energy is the generator of time evolution. So if we want some observable that changes the time in our quantum state, we now use our intuition from classical physics to assert that this Hermitian operator on the right-hand side is the energy operator, also called the Hamiltonian operator. Now, this argument for the Hamiltonian seems to bother some people, and I know it bothered me at first. It's like, so far we've had a fairly mathematical derivation, and suddenly we're making this classical physics assertion for the Hamiltonian? But I want you to understand that it's somewhat impossible to pull the Schrödinger equation out of thin air. I mean, think about it. In order for this equation to describe the world around us, we have to input some information about how our universe acts. Math on its own doesn't understand our universe. The information we therefore input is the fact that energy is the generator of time evolution. Now, there's one last thing we have to do. This is physics, so we need to be careful with units. On the left, the time derivative gives us units of inverse seconds. And on the right, the Hamiltonian gives us units of energy, or joules. These clearly don't match. Therefore, we need to introduce a constant to match the units. If we add a constant to the left-hand side, then it needs to have units of energy times seconds, or joule seconds, in order to cancel out the inverse seconds. So we add a constant with those units, a constant that we call the reduced Planck constant, and we have to determine its value through experiment. And there it is, one of the most important equations in physics, the Schrödinger equation. Now that we've shown where it comes from, let's go ahead and recap how we got each term. That way we understand what every single piece means. D over dt is the change in time of the quantum state. Planck's constant shows up because we need the units of both sides to match. Now, if we trace back through the derivation, you'll see that this I shows up because time evolution is unitary, which we derived mainly from probability conservation. Therefore, this I conserves probability. Many people wonder why quantum mechanics needs imaginary numbers. Well, there you go. It's to conserve probability. Lastly, the Hamiltonian shows up because classical physics tells us that energy generates time evolution. And there it is. Now you know what each piece of the Schrödinger equation is and where it comes from. You should be incredibly proud of yourself for making it this far in the series. We've worked really hard to get here, and I commend you for sticking through it. Your reward is that you now have an understanding of one of the greatest equations discovered by mankind. This was a pretty math-heavy video, so I'm going to end it here. Now, there are still open questions. For example, how do we go from the equation we derived to the one most people see in their introductory quantum classes? On this note, next episode we'll derive the form of the momentum operator, and we'll see how the position-basis Schrödinger equation comes about. So stay tuned as we continue our quantum journey. Thank you so much for watching. As always, leave a comment if you have any questions, and I hope to see you in the rest of the series.